people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. India has kicked off the second phase of its massive immunization program aimed at inoculating 300 million Indians by July-August this year. The second phase is also set to boost the pace that the Indian vaccination process requires in order to reach its 1.3 billion people. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and several members of his cabinet opted for the homegrown Covaxin, which has demonstrated 81% efficacy in preventing the disease in the third round of its clinical trials.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi became the first person to receive the vaccine jab as India widened its immunization program. People above 60 and those above 45 with medical history will be vaccinated in the second phase. Modi, whose diplomatic endeavours during the pandemic have won him global applause, urged others too to get themselves vaccinated. India, which has authorized two vaccines, AstraZeneca's Covishield and indigenously developed Covaxin, has already carried out nearly 15 million inoculations, with its first phase covering a larger portion of frontline and healthcare workers. India aims to vaccinate 300 million of its citizens by July-August this year, and the second phase of vaccination drive is expected to cover nearly 270 million people. And after initial doubts and hesitation, a large number of them are turning up at the centres. So much so that the government has increased the number of centres and is mulling to do even more.
लोगों को डरना नहीं चाहिए और ये वैक्सीनेशन ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा लोगों को अपने आप को लगवाने चाहिए ताकि वो अपने आप को भी सेफ रखें और लोगों की भी सेफ्टी का ध्यान रखें।
While India's 1.3 plus billion population has been dubbed as major challenge to its vaccination program, the government has reassured its citizens that there was no shortage of vaccines in the country. It has successfully managed to flatten the curve in almost all states, barring two, where the situation has been slightly worrying but under control. Meanwhile, India's homegrown COVID-19 vaccine has shown an interim vaccine efficacy of 81% in late-stage clinical trials. The interim analysis was based on 43 recorded cases of COVID-19 in the trial of 25,800 participants conducted in partnership with the Indian government's medical research body.
We just got to know the data, that our efficacy data are clearly indicating around the trend indicating around 80.6.
India had approved the vaccine, branded Covaxin, in January on the basis of promising immunogenicity and safety results demonstrated by the vaccine. India has maintained that it is producing vaccines not only for Indians, but its endeavour has been to strengthen the global fight against the pandemic. Vaccines produced in India are now being used by around two dozen countries.
पहिलो चरणमा हामीले उपहार पायौँ दोस्रोमा हामी चार डलरमा 20 लाख डोज खरिद गऱ्यौँ जसको 10 लाख आइसकेको छ 10 लाख अब तुरन्तै आउनेवाला छ त्यसपछि हामी 50 लाख डोजको खरिद प्रक्रिया अगाडि बढाउन चाहिँ निगोसिएसनमा चरणमा छ विभाग कम्पनीसँग। यही क्रममा चाहिँ अब त्यो पुरा भइसकेपछि कोभ्याक्सको पनि आइसकेपछि हामी सहज ढङ्गले अगाडि बढाउँ।
However, the growing Indian demand and its expanding influence hasn't been taken well by all. Cyber intelligence firm Cypherma has reported that a state-backed Chinese hacking group targeted the IT systems of two Indian vaccine makers whose coronavirus vaccine shots are being used in the country's immunization campaign. Although being denied by Beijing, the vaccine war is already appearing to be real, where some are constantly working for the benefit of the humanity, while others have clearly prioritized commercial, strategic, and competitive diplomatic interests over the rest.
Moving on. As COVID restrictions ease, Balochs have resumed their anti-park freedom struggle on streets. First week of March, when Baloch usually celebrate their ethnicity and culture, a number of demonstrations were held across European cities. Baloch called out violent campaigns by Pakistan Army and its secret agency ISI, a rising number of enforced disappearances and continued plunder of their resources. They urged the international community to intervene in the crisis that is gradually heading towards a state-sponsored catastrophe.
As COVID restrictions ease around the world, the Balochs, with their long-standing demand of complete independence from the clutches of Islamabad, have once again taken to streets. They staged a number of demonstrations in European cities of Berlin, Frankfurt and Amsterdam this week. While calling Pakistan's army murderers and occupier, the Balochs highlighted an armed offensive being carried out against them in Balochistan. They also urged the international community to take cognizance of the rising rate of enforced disappearances in the region.
Baloch must know that there is a continuous genocide of the Baloch nation, which is carried out by Pakistan since the annexation of Balochistan at the barrel of gun by Pakistani army. And one of the worst human rights violation which is being happened in Balochistan, that has the enforcement disappearances of the Baloch people.
The Balochs, who have lately upped the ante in their demands of freedom, accuse Pakistan establishment of unleashing a repressive campaign to muzzle the liberal voices in the region. The crackdown involves arresting activists on trumped-up charges and subjecting them to inhuman torture in detention centers. There have been over 50,000 cases of disappearances in Balochistan so far. The barbarity has only gained strength with time as the establishment-backed goons attack innocents with impunity. Even those who have managed to flee Pakistan have not been spared. Balochs accuse Pakistani agencies of killing Baloch dissenters overseas. Karima Baloch and Sajid Hussain were found dead under similar suspicious circumstances last year. Baloch say ISI killed them. Leaders say it is high time that all Balochs unite and present a stronger fight for their rights.
ये हमारे लिए शर्म का मकाम है कि एक जगह पे हमारे भाई मर रहे हैं, कट रहे हैं, शहीद हो रहे हैं, कुर्बान हो रहे हैं, मजामत कर रहे हैं, लड़ रहे हैं, और दूसरी तरफ से हम तमाशा देखते रहे हैं। और फिर ये मौका है खेस बात होगी अगर हम खुद खामोश रहें और दुनिया से तवक्को करें कि दुनिया हमारे लिए आवाज़ उठाएगी। दुनिया हमारे लिए कभी आवाज़ नहीं उठाएगी जब तक हम अपने लिए खुद आवाज़ नहीं उठाते।
Despite being endowed with oil, coal gas, electricity and gold, the Baluch people still live in dire conditions with no electricity or running water. Furthermore, following the entry of the Chinese in the province, the Baluch have been exploited even more. Balochistan was under the British colonial rule and it was annexed by Islamabad on August 27, 1948. And since then, all its demands have been responded through military operations. The locals are neither made part of the committees that take decision of exploiting the resources, nor they are shared any dividends of the produce. And when they demand their rights or resist the forceful changes being brought about in their region, Pakistan uses brute high-handedness to suppress them.
We are now joined by Munir Bengal, president of Baloch Voice Association in France, who along with other Balochs held a photo exhibition in front of United Nations. So, Mr. Baloch, what is the current situation of Balochs and tell us more about the new methods being adopted by your movement, including the photo exhibitions in front of UN?
Actually, the main purpose of this photo exhibition in front of a United Nations building is to present this human rights situation to the world community, to the United Nations, to her bodies, that how the Baloch people are suffering over there by the hands of the Pakistani army. Actually, in Balochistan, you will find worse kind of subjugation, worse kind of colonization. You cannot imagine how Pakistan army is brutally killing, abducting, and keeping the people under subjugation. So there's not one area, one field where you can say that these are being treated as human beings. On one side, we see there are military operations where the Pakistani army forces, they cordon off an area and then they start their military operation with helicopter guns, with killing the people extrajudicially and looting the resources of the houses and eliminating the people. All that is being done on a routine basis. On the second side, we see that the people are being victims of enforced disappearances. You cannot imagine that how, if you take a person for years, he is being disappeared. Even his family members, mother, sisters, daughters, husband, no one knows where he or she is and what is her or his fate.
Pakistan says that CPEC will bring prosperity to the lives of Balochs too. What is your take?
Can you imagine that there is no drinking water in Gwadar, and this is what Pakistan had requested Swiss government, that they should finance for a water treatment plant in Gwadar? Then why? What are these projects? What is CPEC? Whether this is a development project or some sort of specific military designs? Only you are giving some benefits to the foreigners, Chinese. For them, you are building very good houses. For them, you have water facilities. For them, you have sports centers. For them, but for the local people, you are not even giving them water. And on the other side, our education system is worst of that. And you have seen the pictures were there. I have presented the photos of the schools there. The kids are sitting, you know, without having a chair, without having a roof on their head. They are just sitting on the sun and getting education. And this is called education system, what the Pakistan is giving to the Baloch people. So all these sort of signs by keeping deprived the people from basic facilities like health, education, and from their getting a normal bread and butter is a worst kind of subjugation. And on the other side, you are trying to eliminate the people by military operations, by enforced disappearances. This is something which not a Baloch, but the international organizations like Human Rights Watch, UNPO and others, they have said that there is a slow motion genocide of the Baloch people.
Moving on. It's been over 6 months since the British Kashmiri journalist and rights activist Tanveer Ahmed has been languishing in jail. While the video evidence available in the public domain doesn't find him guilty of anything wrong, the administration in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir has been treating him like a terrorist. A shoddy investigation, compromised judiciary, and Islamabad's unrelenting efforts to keep him behind bars have only added to obstacles in his release. People have carried out protests, but not enough to trigger an international response. The media has been silent, and now nobody knows what his future would be like.
Tanveer Ahmed is not appearing to be coming out of jail anytime soon. Despite his non-culpability in the crime he has been framed for, the British Kashmiri journalist Tanveer Ahmed's future is in jeopardy. While any international legal assistance cannot reach him, the Islamabad-installed judiciary has been a sellout, or to say it more precisely, a stooge who has only furthered and facilitated the government's repressive ambitions. The government of Pakistan has ensured over the years that the mechanics of so-called independent POK judiciary are under its control and judges compliant.
अदालतों में पाकिस्तानी सिक्योरिटी एजेंसीज के लोग बैठे होते हैं और उनकी मौजूदगी में जज साहब तो कुछ और सोच भी नहीं सकते, अगर सोचें भी तो वो बहुत बड़ा जुर्म करेंगे। लिहाजा वहां की जो अदालतें हैं, ये तनवीर अहमद के केस के हवाले से, बाकी भी और बहुत कुछ है, खास करके तनवीर अहमद के केस के हवाले से तो किसी किस्म का कुछ शक व शुबा नहीं रहना चाहिए।
The Tanveer Ahmed case has met the fate of dozens of other activists who dare to raise their voice against the establishment and ended up being sentenced to 70 years to 90 years of rigorous terms in jail. Kashmiri activists who fled the state-backed attacks following their demands for independence are mulling large-scale movement to gain freedom. They say they have the first rights over the resources and time has come to claim them.
लोगों को ये सोचने का मकाम है कि वो अपनी सोचों में तब्दीली लाएं ताकि रियासत भी आजाद हो और पाकिस्तान के अपने मामलात हैं वो जारी रखें। इस तरीके से काम किए जाएं कि पाकिस्तान से हमारी जल्द से जल्द जान छुटे ताकि हम अपनी रियासत को एक आजाद खुद मुख्तार रियासत बना सकें, उस रियासत के अंदर रहने वालों को जो वकार है वो मिल सके। पाकिस्तान ने तो अपने लोगों को वकार नहीं दिया, हमें कहाँ देंगे। लिहाजा हमारी बेहतरी इसी में है कि हमें पाकिस्तान के कब्जे के खिलाफ मुतहद होकर जद्दोजहद करनी पड़ेगी ताकि हम अपने वसाइल के साथ साथ लोगों की जो इज्जत वकार है उसको भी बहाल कर सकें।
इन द लास्ट फ्यू ईयर्स पाकिस्तान हैज इंटेंसिफाइड इट्स क्रैकडाउन ऑन द राइट टू फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन इन POK. Political activists and journalists are targeted and charged under draconian laws, including the Prevention of Electronic Crimes Act, the Anti-Terrorism Act, and sections of the Penal Code on sedition and defamation. Media freedoms have been curtailed, with editors experiencing a growing culture of censorship, coercion, and harassment by the authorities. Raising voice for basic human and fundamental rights, demanding for ownership of natural resources and self-governance, criticism on wrongdoings of establishment and subservient judiciary has become almost blasphemous.
वो ये कहना चाहते हैं कि ये जो खिता पुरामन खिता है, जहां लोग पुरामन तरीके से रह रहे हैं, हर तरह के जबर पर जो खामोशी इख्तियार की हुए हैं, वो चाहते हैं कि इस खित्ते के अंदर को माहौल थोड़ा सा गर्म हो। और मुझे यकीन है कि जितना जबर इस खित्ते के ऊपर है, जो जम्मू कश्मीर का वो इलाका जो पाकिस्तान के जेर कब्जा है, वहां का नौजवान जरूर उठेगा और उनको बताएगा कि किस तरीके से जबर के खिलाफ जरा वाला कौमें उठा करती है और किस तरीके से लड़ा करती है।
पाकिस्तान इनसिक्योरिटी अगेंस्ट कश्मीरी एक्टिविस्ट, both political and social, has manifested in its extrajudicial operations over the years. It has preemptively targeted and suppressed the voices demanding rights and freedoms in its illegally occupied territories of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. And Tanveer Ahmed's case is no exception, but a grim reminder of brutalities being meted out on Kashmiris at the pretext of law and order. For now, Tanveer Ahmed is in tight Pakistani clutches with hopes of freedom diminishing with every rising sun.
Rivers in India have great religious significance among the people. And if we talk about the holy river Ganga, it is considered as a goddess in the Hindu religion. Hindus across India believe that the mere sprinkling of Ganga water cleanses all sins and that taking a dip in the sacred river bestows heavenly blessings. Today we will take you to India's northern holy cities where devotees throng the ghats of the Ganga to mark the festival of Maghi Purnima. Have a look.
Scores of Hindu devotees flock to ghats of river Ganga in India's temple towns of Varanasi and Prayagraj to mark the festival of Maghi Purnima amid the coronavirus pandemic. Hindus believe that the water of river Ganga has the properties to cure several diseases and it is also used during religious ceremonies for purification. Maghi Purnima is the full moon night that falls in the Magh month of the Hindu calendar and is a revered occasion for the devotees. On this occasion, devotees offer prayers, perform rituals and take a holy dip in the revered rivers to absolve their misdeeds and seek blessings from the gods.
एक महीने के पूरे कल्पवास के बाद यह माघ का आखिरी स्नान है और इसके पश्चात यह एक आखिरी स्नान और होगा महाशिवरात्रि का.
Similar scenes were witnessed in India's Haridwar town, which is known as the gateway to heaven, where devotees took a holy dip in river Ganga and offered special prayers for their well-being and prosperity. Some devotees also observe a fast, take bath before the sunrise, and they have a meal only after sighting of the moon.
कुंभ मेले का स्नान करने के लिए आए, आज पूर्णमासी का स्नान था, आज यहाँ पे स्नान करने के लिए आए और गंगा मैया की कृपा से जो कोविड खत्म हो रहा है उसकी कामना करते हैं कि सारा संसार ठीक ठाक हो जाए.
According to Hindu mythology, it is believed that on this day, Vishnu, the Hindu god of preservation, is present in the Ganga, and by bathing in the river, the devotees can get rid of all their troubles. This is what makes Ganga an indispensable element in all prayers and religious ceremonies. It is through these festivals that citizens of India stay in touch with their rituals and traditions and keep themselves grounded to their roots.
According to Hindu mythology, the water of River Ganga descended on the earth through the locks of Lord Shiva to help mankind wash away their sins. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.